There's one human invention so fundamental to our lives that every known modern culture can make it. You could argue it's one of the top three most important things we've ever made as a species, behind stone tools and fire. And it has really stuck with us. You probably have some of this tacky tech in your craft drawer. So, let's talk about glue. Glue, or more formally, an adhesive, is a substance that holds two or more things together all on its own with no machinery required. Welding, soldering, or bolts? Not glue. You need other tools to make those work. But sticky gunk? Now that's what I call glue. And glue's smearability and moldability, or plasticity, are some of its greatest strengths. Soft, liquid glue can be drizzled and molded onto odd-shaped objects and then left to dry to hold them together. Okay, so that might not be super mind-blowing today, but at one point, this was cutting-edge technology. The earliest glues came from plants. If you've leaned on a tree and your hand came up sticky, you've encountered the original glue ingredient, tree resin. And if you were living in the Stone Age, and you wanted to refine some of this sticky stuff for yourself, here's what you'd do. Gather up lots of tree bark, probably birch or pine, then roll it up, throw it in the embers of a fire, and cover it with ash to try to keep the temperature down and the air out. You don't want to burn it all away, after all. After 20 or 30 minutes, you might get about 1 gram of cooked down resin, called tar, for every 100 grams of bark you bake. Scrape the tar off of the bark and use it while it's hot to glue some rocks and sticks together. That's hypothesized to be how we got the oldest known example of a tool built with glue. Roughly 200,000 years ago, someone stuck two rock flakes together with birch tar. And in 2001, researchers announced that they'd found those rocks under the ribs of an ancient elephant. Together, they look like a blade and a handle. Now, let's put that into perspective. For more than 2 million years before that, all our tools were just individual rocks, and we have no direct evidence that those rocks were connected to anything else. You had big hammer stones to smash stuff or sharp flakes of rock to cut stuff, but you'd be holding onto the rock itself in your hand. More complex stone tools were actually sharpened and shaped into points, but can you imagine using a knife without a handle? It's very difficult. If you want to throw your sharp rock really far to kill your prey, or you want some leverage on your knife while you cut up that meal, it helps to attach that stone tool to something else. Enter glue. Archaeologists are generally really excited to find tar on stone tools because it represents a massive technological and cognitive leap by humans and our extinct hominin relatives. It takes creativity to realize that a rock on a stick is better than a rock by itself, and serious problem-solving skills to figure out how to put them together with the gunk from some slow-roasted tree bark. But that leap allowed early humans to create tools with handles and hafts, like arrows, spears, and domestic tools, that would make essential tasks like hunting much easier. Those earlier humans may have discovered resin glues after burning bark in campfires and finding all that tar left behind. And it doesn't take a huge leap to then scrape it off and stick it to stuff. But it wasn't just us that made this connection. That 200,000 year old glue I mentioned earlier was Neanderthal made. Over a couple tens of thousands of years, we think Neanderthals managed to develop a pretty elaborate glue making process. There's one site from about 65,000 years ago where they'd made a dedicated mound-shaped hearth that could pull resin from birch and other plants more efficiently than just a pile of ash. But our own species wasn't out of the glue-making game. One of the earliest examples of this comes from around 80,000 to 60,000 years ago, when humans at a site in South Africa called Sabudu Cave were using an adhesive made from conifer resin and ochre. While resin-based glues served us well for tens of thousands of years, they couldn't do everything. Around 8,000 years ago, humans started to make glue from the tough bits left over from butchering meat and fish, and even leftover plant scraps. When preparing fresh meat for dinner, the parts of the animal, including connective tissue, like tendons, ligaments, and cartilage, and other leftovers like the hide and bladder, are not usually on the menu. But they are far from useless since they're full of a molecule called collagen. When you prepare it right, collagen makes a great base for glue. All you need to do is heat it in water to between 60 and 79 degrees degrees Celsius, long enough for the coiled up collagen molecules to unravel. These collagen molecules are made of three chains twisted together like a rope and held together with magnet-like hydrogen bonds. When heated, the rope unravels, and that's your chance to smear your collagen-based glue on whatever you want to stick together. Then, when the glue cools, the chains want to join together again because of that magnet-like adhesive force, but they also hold on to whatever you've applied the glue to. You can create different glues depending on what animal parts you use to make it and whether it was mixed with other sticky substances like plant resin. Cultures around the world developed collagen glues at different times for different reasons. True to glue's combat-related past, collagen glue was used to make layered wooden shields in ancient Rome, but it also had artistic applications like holding together terracotta sculptures in ancient China, and it was an important part of plaster in ancient Egypt. Later, it would be used for gilding artworks in 18th century Italy. Collagen-based glues were popular through the 19th century, which means glue making got the Industrial Revolution treatment. The world's first glue factory opened in Holland in the 1700s, and the rest is horse jokes and history. Most of us don't use collagen-based glues today, unless you're into woodworking or violin making. For the rest of us, glue probably brings to mind basic white Elmer's glue or even super glue. But before you ask, no, these common household glues generally don't use animal products. They're mostly made of plastic. And like the original resin-based glues of the Stone Age, the first plastic-based glues were invented to make weapons. The most common craft glues use a chemical called polyvinyl acetate, or PVA. PVA was discovered in 1912 by chemist Fritz Klatte. He worked for a chemical company that made lye and calcium carbide, a chemical used in the steel industry. And the process of making both of these things created a lot of chemical byproducts, which nobody really had a use for. Klatte figured out how to turn those byproducts into long, chain-like molecules called polymers, like PVA and another familiar plastic, polyvinyl chloride, or PVC. And it turns out, both of those are really useful. Mixing PVA and water creates that familiar white liquid glue, which hardens and turns clear when the water either evaporates or seeps into whatever you're gluing together. One of the first uses of PVA glue was as a lacquer coating for German planes during World War I. Apparently, it didn't have a great reputation for that, though. Better to stick to arts and crafts. If you want something a little stronger, you might reach for superglue. Superglue, also known as cyanoacrylate, didn't come on the scene until the 1940s. During World War II, chemist Harry Coover was working to develop a super clear plastic that could be used in gun scopes. And the researchers had happened upon this material that was clear, but also ridiculously sticky. Any contact with moisture, even just from the air, would cause the molecules to start linking together into longer polymers and harden. It wasn't great for the lenses like he'd hoped, so he moved on to other materials. Coover returned to his accidental invention after the war in 1951 while working on airplanes, and realized that there was an upside to the sticky situation his wartime research had created. Cyanoacrylates are different from PVA glues because of when the polymers form. The polymers in craft glue come pre-made in the bottle, but cyanoacrylates only form their all-important polymers after you squeeze the glue out of the bottle. That gives the molecules the chance to stick to everything. Each other, your DIY project, the table you're working on, and your hands. Coover filed for his patent in 1954, and the first version of superglue hit the shelves in 1958. The molecules each contain electron-heavy nitrogen, which has a magnet-like pull toward the hydrogen atoms of other molecules. There's also a pattern of double and single bonds that are primed to form long chains, with a little nudge from moisture in the environment. When dry, superglue dissolves in a mild solution like nail polish remover or lemon juice, so keep that in mind if you ever have any superglue-based disasters at home. And just like the glues of old, cyanoacrylates reached the battlefield eventually, not in the weapons, but in medical bags. During the Vietnam War, US medics used a spray-on version of superglue to temporarily stop major bleeding, which gave them more time to get the wounded to hospitals. It wasn't technically approved for medical use at the time, but field medics had other priorities. Coover applied for approval of a medical cyanoacrylate in 1964 from the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, which had to be different from the original version for a few reasons. For one thing, when superglue dries, it releases heat, which can lead to burns, and the polymer can degrade into toxic compounds like formaldehyde, which you don't want on an open wound. Cyanoacrylate is also really firm when it dries, and when it comes to medical adhesive, you want something that moves with the skin as it heals instead of something that's brittle or sharp. Other countries were playing around with medical cyanoacrylates by the 1970s, but they didn't hit the market for a little while, and the FDA only approved the first one for use in the US in 1998. And now, surgeons use substances that are similar to superglue to fix blood vessels, seal ulcers, and repair bleeding organs. Dental surgeons use it too. It turns out that glue is useful in medicine for the same reasons that our ancestors wanted it tens of thousands of years ago. It's sticky, it's flexible, so it can hold together odd-shaped stuff without the use of outside machinery. But there are still challenges in making medical glues better. Our tissues are wet, like all the time, which makes it hard to use a glue that needs to dry in order to stick stuff to them. Luckily, we can draw inspiration from the animal kingdom, specifically shellfish. Marine mussels are fantastic at sticking to rocks and metal, and they can hang on through crashing waves and submersion in salt water. So scientists are studying their natural glue, called mussel foot proteins, to see what we can learn. And they've honed in on a part of the mussel foot protein called DOPA. They're still figuring out exactly how it works, but they do know that DOPA is key to mussels' ability to stick to so many surfaces underwater. And since it works in the ocean, which is the wettest of the wet, that could make it useful for medical applications. There have been a few trials of DOPA-based glues in mice, and one team of researchers created a DOPA-based glue that could help during fetal surgery, like surgery on a fetus inside a pregnant person. Fetal surgery can treat a bunch of critical conditions early enough that they don't impact fetal development and result in healthier babies at birth, which is amazing, but also risky because the surgeon needs to get into the amniotic sac without damaging it. So this research team worked on a DOPA-based patch that they could apply to the amniotic sac, then insert the surgical tools through that patch for a watertight seal. They also hope it might prevent the damage from surgery from spreading beyond the incision. But it's still a work in progress. That research was done in rabbit models, and for now, there are no clinical trials for muscle-inspired glue in progress, but hey, maybe someday. It's clear that the human desire to stick stuff to other stuff has brought us a long way from birch tar. We started this journey putting rocks on sticks to build weapons, which we used to cut things apart. So it's kind of awesome that the future frontiers of glue making are all about putting things back together again.